Sometimes preachers get up and they start speaking and they're working for however long, 15 minutes, half hour, 45 minutes, whatever. And we work ourselves to a point. This morning, I want to start with the point and then unpack it a little bit. So if you have your Bibles, Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. Would you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, God, I pray that you would speak to the hearts in the room today. God, that your word would encourage the believers that are gathered here. Father, that the testimony of our lives would draw those here who do not know you closer to you. God, that your spirit would be revealed to them, that they might know Jesus, confess him as Lord, and be saved. Father, I ask for your strength this morning. I pray that your words would come through, that you would hide me, Father, in the shadow of your cross, and that these followers of Jesus Christ here would hear your words speaking to their heart in Jesus' name. Amen. Romans chapter 8. Verse 1, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. Verse 1 starts and says, therefore. I always like to back up when I see that word. It means that there was a great point made in the preceding verses, maybe preceding chapter, maybe even preceding chapters. We see the word therefore in the scripture. It means that whoever is writing is saying, in light of everything I have said previously, now this. So what is said previously? These are awesome words that we find here. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But what has been said before this? Chapter 7, the writer here, his name is Paul. He was a wretched sinner before we knew him as the Apostle Paul. He was persecuting Christians and he did not know the Lord Jesus. He was serving God through tradition and through law. And when his name was Saul, he was the greatest persecutor of the church. And in Romans chapter 7, he kind of fleshes out a little bit of his past for us to learn from, for the believers that he's writing to learn from. He kind of just works things out through Romans chapter 7, and we find, honestly, some awesome verses and at the same time some of the most confusing verses. Just a few verses back in chapter 7, there's the great passage, if you've been around the Bible for a long time, where Paul writes, he's like, the things I want to do, I don't do. The things I don't want to do, I do them, and I don't understand why I can't do the things I want to do, but I can do the things I don't want to do. What's wrong with me? And sometimes we read it and we're like, man, why do you say it that way? It's really confusing. But if you've been struggling with sin in your life, if you've wrestled with coming away from a sinful lifestyle into life with Christ, you probably understand those words greater than you realize. And there was a time when I would read it and I'd be like, why does Paul have to say this so difficult? And then he sums it up. He's like, I find this law at work that when I want to do good, evil is right there with me. So what does he work out in Romans chapter 7 that leads into chapter 8? Well, he points out that there is the law of God. Now, Jews would consider that the law of Moses. That's not something that we follow. That's not something that we are under. But he's writing them. He's like, what about the law? Like, we're not under the law, but is the law still good? Is it spiritual? He works those out. Yes, it is good. And what is the purpose of the law? The purpose of the law is to point out sin. He says in Romans chapter 7, if it wasn't for the law, I wouldn't know what coveting was. I wouldn't know what adultery is. I wouldn't know what idolatry is. But the law has come and has pointed out to me these things are wrong, these things are not of God, and there needs to be a change in our lives. And he gets to the end of the chapter as he's working through all this, as he's processing in his own writing and working it out for the believers. He gets to verse 24 in chapter 7. He says, wretched man that I am, who will save me from this body of death? Because he says that the law couldn't do it. The law is good, but the law cannot save. Rules and regulations and all those things, they cannot save. They can convict you of sin, and they can show you a need for a savior, but it cannot save you. He says, who will save me? I thought it was interesting when I was reading that. I'm like, well, why does he say therefore? And I went back and started reading it. He says, who will save me? He doesn't say what will save me. didn't say, what can I turn to find salvation? In what thing? In what pursuit? In what pleasure? In what possession? What will save me? He says, who will save me? He says, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Paul, knowing that Jesus the Lord is who saves, Jesus the Lord is where we find our salvation from God. By faith, we believe in Jesus Christ and we find the grace of God in our lives. So then he comes in to Romans chapter 8 after working through all of that, and he says, therefore, in light of Christ being the only one that can save us and the law pointing out our need for a Savior and what is wrong in our lives, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I've just been burdened lately as I look around the world and relationships that I know and the church, just as I look at Christians, as I look at my own life, look into my past, I used to feel a strong regret. I don't know if regret is bad because maybe it points out, hey, you were wrong, you are wrong, you need a change in your life. But there was a point in time where I would just carry the weight of my sin. Like, I wouldn't let go of it. I just kept condemning myself. I held myself under condemnation. What I've done, the things I've done, the places I've been, the people I have hurt, the words that I have said. I was holding condemnation over myself, not remembering that Jesus Christ brings freedom. Maybe not even forgetting it, maybe simply not realizing yet. Maybe simply not understanding in my own life yet that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is liberty. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We are blessed at the Rock through the preaching of the word that God has called us to see amounts of people standing and confessing Jesus Christ as Savior. And honestly, it's inconceivable to me every week, whether it's one or 100, it does not matter, to watch a soul be confronted by their need for Jesus and to stand and confess him is simply an awesome miracle by the hand of God. But then my burden becomes, have people realized, as you've stood in this room, as you've confessed Christ, in small groups, in Bible studies, at winter camps with the youth group, at summer camps, at men's retreats and women's retreats, and wherever, have people truly realized that when you have come to the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, the condemnation is gone and it is over for you? The condemnation ends at the saving, redemptive work of Jesus Christ in your life. What is that condemnation hindering you from? Have you realized your freedom? You are not bound. You are not enslaved any longer. It says there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and as an offering for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. See in verse 3, he says there what the law could not do. I don't know if you're in the room this morning and you are trying to ascend your way to the throne of God through regulations and rules, but the law cannot do what you are trying to have it do if that is you. If you are trying to walk through the observances of man, through rules that were placed on you, maybe rules without reason as you were growing, as you were a young person, maybe in a church or parents or something somewhere started to impose rules on you without reason, say, you need to do this because this is what is good. You follow this. This is what we do. This is how we act. And it was not guided by the word of God, and Jesus Christ was not the Lord of those rules, then they were simply rules of morality and acting good with people. The law cannot save you. He says, for what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh. It just points out sin. It convicts you of sin. It shows you your error. It cannot save you. Paul says, well, what did? If the law cannot, what did? God did. Again, not what, but who. Paul said, who will save me from the body of this death? Who? God. How? Sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh as an offering for sin. In these quick couple of verses here, Paul just lays out the gospel for us. It's amazing. Sometimes we overcomplicate it. We say a lot of words. We go through a lot of things to communicate sin, Christ, Savior. But right here, he just lays it out. He's like, God did it. He sent his son in the likeness of sinful flesh, just like us. The Bible says that Jesus Christ sympathizes with us because he was tempted in all ways as we are, yet he was without sin. It says that the fullness of God was found in the flesh of man. Philippians says he was found in appearance as a man, the very nature of God found in appearance as a man. God dwelled among us in our flesh as a sin offering. Verse 4, so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Again, pointing out that it's not something that you can do. It's not something that you can atone for. God sent Jesus to atone for something that we could not. God sent the flesh of Jesus Christ to die what we could not die, to bear what we could not bear, so that the requirement of the law, verse 4, so the requirement of the law, which is what? Death. What does the law require? Well, if the law points out sin, and the wages of sin is death, the requirement of the law is death, might be fulfilled in us, but not by us. By Jesus. We believe on Jesus Christ, who fulfilled the requirement of the law. And when we believe on Jesus Christ, the requirement is fulfilled in us by the grace of God. So that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. We're going to deal with that just a little bit here this morning. In these next verses, we're going to talk about the flesh and the Spirit. Maybe you're like, I don't know if this pertains to me. I don't know if I have believed in Jesus in my life. I'm glad you're here today. And if you know, sitting here this morning, that you have placed your faith and hope and confidence in Jesus Christ, but you struggle with the flesh, I'm glad you're here today. Because the Word of God always speaks to all people. It's never like we're not talking to this part of the room over here. We're just talking to like this section right here. No, we're talking to all people. That the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who are according to the flesh, what are we talking about? Verse 5, for those who are according to the flesh, those who walk in the way of the world, those who live the sinful, natural nature of the world, those who live according to the flesh, set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who are according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. So now we see the only two lines that are drawn in all of humanity. And we, as humans, we draw a lot of lines culturally, racially, skin colors, languages, you name it. We draw a lot of lines. God draws one line and has two groups of people. Those who walk according to the flesh and those who walk according to the Spirit. Those who are redeemed and those who are in need of being redeemed, the sinner, the saved. It says that those who are according to the flesh set their mind on the things of the flesh. So maybe you hear this morning, you're like, I don't know which one I am. I don't know what I walk in. I believe Jesus, and that's good. But even the demons that are in hell who are never going to spend eternity in heaven believe in Jesus. You can't just end at belief. Have you acted upon the belief? Those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the flesh. What is your mind set on? What fills your thoughts? What is your time spent on? Where's your life going? What is it for? What are you living for? Who are you living for? Well, if it's the flesh, if it's the ways of the world, then you can understand that you walk according to the flesh. A regenerate life, changed by the Spirit of God through belief in Jesus Christ, receiving the grace of God for their sins, being saved, finds their need for change and does not walk to satisfy the flesh, does not live to fulfill the desires of this world, does not look and say, I want, I will have, but looks to Jesus, looks to the Word, looks to God and says, what do I need, Father? How do I live before you and how do I live among man? Those who live according to the flesh set their mind on the things of the flesh. But those who are according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Is your mind consumed with thoughts of the Lord? I mean consumed. Like you're getting a little crazy, preacher. Yes, I mean consumed. We got a lot of things we got to take care of in life, but are you consumed? Are you thinking of the things of the Spirit? In everyday life, when something comes up, what does the Word say? When something happens, Heavenly Father, I come before you. When someone needs encouragement, when someone needs help, are you set on the things of the Spirit? Are you walking according to the Spirit? Verse 6. For the mind set on the flesh is death. But the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. Because the mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God. For it does not subject itself to the law of God, for it is not even able to do so, and those who are in the flesh cannot please God. The mind set on the flesh is death. I'm devastated when I think about those who are born into this life and will walk every step of every day of earthly existence, come to the end, never know Jesus. Never hear the good news. Never believe, never confess, never call on the name of the Lord. They'll come to the end of this life. They will physically die, and then they will spiritually die for all time. That's not a life that ever lived. You are born into death, separated from God, and you died in death, separated from God, to be separated from God for eternity. That should shake us, believers in Christ. That should cause heartbreak for the people around us that are not saved. That should motivate us to share the good news of Jesus Christ with everyone. Let them tell you, I don't want to hear it. Okay, then I'm going to leave you alone with God. Let them say the words, please do not tell me about your Jesus. That doesn't mean we don't do it. They don't want to hear it. Don't let that stop you. Share the good news of Jesus Christ, because those who live according to the flesh, the mind set on flesh is death. That is the only outcome. There is no alternate route. There is no plan B when this life is over. Those who live according to the flesh face death, period. But the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. That's a better option. We can walk through this entire life, but if we don't know Jesus Christ, we are not fulfilled. If we don't find the hope of God, the hope of glory, we're not fulfilled. We're empty, but when we do, when the mind is set on those things, when the heart is focused on those things, when the life is lived in an expression of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, life and peace. What does that mean? Like life, one, this one. You're like, this life is pretty rough. Yeah, I know. There are new aches and pains every day. People are dying. There's civil, economic, social unrest. There are wars and rumors of wars. Wow, we're really close to stuff that's talked about in the Bible, aren't we? It's a disaster in this world. But the mind set on the Spirit has found life. And what's the song we sing? Because he lives, right? Life is worth the living because he lives. We find this life worthwhile because of Jesus. We find peace in this life because of Jesus. And then there's the greater promise. We find the hope of eternity with Jesus and everlasting life because of Jesus. We find everlasting peace. It's that song you used to sing when I was a kid. I've got the peace that passes understanding, right? Peace that passes understanding down in my heart because of Jesus Christ. The mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. Why? Because the mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God. I didn't realize when this whole sermon just came out of a Bible study I did this past week, but I had no idea how much it was going to line up with what we're looking at around the world. Like, the Bible's always relevant. People are like, ah, it's an old book. It's an old word. I don't know what it, does it apply today? Oh, yeah. Yeah, and if you don't think it does, then you haven't watched the news this past week. The mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God. That word, hostile, opposed, at war with, stressful, tense. Everybody's walking on eggshells when there's hostility. Everyone's careful of what they say when there's hostility. The mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God. We look in the world, and I've watched a lot of Christians get really upset over the past week. They're sinners, and they're hostile toward God. And before we think, oh, those poor people, let's remember that we once were them as well. Ephesians talks about us being alienated from God. Colossians says you were alienated and hostile in your thinking toward God. Unable to draw near, not desiring a relationship. That's what we, believers in Jesus, were before we believed in Jesus. And sometimes I think we're too quick to forget that. Because the mind set in the flesh is hostile toward God. For it does not subject itself to the law of God. Believers in Jesus have got something new to look at. We come from death to life. Ephesians says, it literally says, death to life. When we believe in Jesus Christ, our spiritual death has been dealt with and we come to life through Jesus. Not so for those that don't know Christ. It does not subject itself to the law of God. People are like, I just believe that I will do enough good. And maybe I'm touching a nerve in the room. I don't know. But people are like, I'll do enough good in my life so that when I die, God will be pleased with me. I'm a good person. I have good morals. I do good things. I will continue to. And when I die, what kind of God is going to find a problem with that? The one found here. We must believe in Jesus Christ as the risen Son of God and confess him as Savior and Lord, because no amount of good can bridge the gap that he bridged through his death. People are like, I'll just do enough good. The prophet Isaiah says that all of your good, all of our good, even collectively in this room, separated from Jesus Christ, let alone the world, all of our good piled up, separated from Jesus Christ, the prophet Isaiah says, are not but filthy rags. They are nothing. There is not an amount of good that a person can do. And when a person is separated from God, they are hostile toward God, and they are not subject to the law of God. They are sinners, helpless, powerless, in need of saving, but not so the believer. That's why the first verse is so incredible, because we look at that and we're like, well, that's pretty awful. But if you believe in Jesus Christ, there is now no condemnation. There's condemnation found for those who are hostile to God, for those who are not subject to the law of God. There's condemnation for them here, likely on this earth, and certainly in eternity. There is condemnation, but not for us. Look what else it says about the mind that is in the flesh, those who live and walk according to the world, the end of verse 7 into verse 8. It is not subject to the law of God, for it is not even able to do so. The mind of unrepentant, unregenerate hearts cannot submit itself to the law of God. I go to church, I do all these good things, I go through all the motions and through all the parts, but if the heart has not been changed, if the mind is not set on the Spirit of God, you're not able. And then verse 8, and while the hard one. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. He's not happy with those who walk in the flesh, with those who live and walk according to the world. People in church, followers of Christ, we need to not be in the world. Romans says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world. We must look at the world and die to it. Paul says, I've been crucified with Christ, and it's no longer I that live. We must look at the world, the things of the world, the ways of the world, and they must become dead to us. We cannot walk according to the flesh and expect to please God. Not even able to do so. Let's stop holding sinners up to the standard of the Word of God. Let's stop that. Let's not look at a sinful life and just say, they're going to hell. They may be, but are you sharing the good news that would prevent that? Because if not, then I'm sorry, I don't know what God you're believing in. If you look at a life that you know is going to hell and you don't take action, if you don't move toward the cross of Jesus Christ in the life of that person, oh my gosh. Let's stop holding sinners to the standards of God and let's take the cross of Jesus to them, so that minds that live and walk according to the flesh can live and walk according to the Spirit. Verse 9, Paul changes here. First, he starts talking about those in the flesh. They're hostile toward God. Their mind is set on the flesh. They are not subject to the law of God. They are not able to be subject to the law of God, and they are not able to please God. Then in verse 9, however, big word, and wow, I'm glad for it in my own life. However, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. I just would like everyone to think about that for a minute. If you sit here regenerated by the power of God, if you sit here believing, professing, claiming Jesus Christ, I believe, I'm saved. You're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Boy, do I sit with people and they're like, I believe I'm saved. I made this decision in my life. Are you living that out? Are you in the Word? Are you in prayer? Are you in community with believers? Are you actively living out your faith among the world that is around us? Questions, conversation will go on. And the answer to every one of those questions becomes no. I need to. I really keep meaning to have a better prayer life. I know I need to be in the Word a lot more. And I know, well, I see people, I know they don't know Jesus, and I should probably say something to them. Like, what are you saying? Like, people answer those questions. I don't even know if sometimes some people in this room, you may not even understand what you're saying, but like, do you really know God? Has the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus truly set you free? Because I believe, and call me crazy, that when he does, that produces change in us. That we can't just be status quo anymore. That we can't just look like a Christian. That we can't just be seen carrying a Bible. That we can't just let people watch us walk into church. Come to this service we're doing. Come to this thing. Like, I go to church and I do this stuff. Like, no, there needs to be fruit in our lives. What fruit is there in your life? Paul says, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Paul saying in his own writing, like, I know what you say, but only you and God know if that's true. And one day you're going to stand before him. And the truth of that statement is going to matter a lot. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. So you're like, well, how do I know if the Spirit of God dwells in me? Well, all this year we've been doing outreach in various towns and cities across the area. We do outreach here almost every single Sunday by preaching the gospel and the good news of Jesus Christ and calling sinners to repentance. That's what we are to be doing. And we say, because the Bible says that if you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, notice the full statement of that verse, Romans 10:9. If you believe in your heart, not just if you believe in Jesus. Romans 10:9 does not simply say, if you believe in Jesus. It says, if you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. The resurrection of the crucified Savior, Jesus Christ, matters in your belief. Do you believe in the risen Lamb of God, Jesus Christ? Then it says, if you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead and confess with your mouth that he is Lord, you'll be saved. It goes on to say, for it is with the heart we believe and are saved. It is the mouth that we confess and are justified. Verse 13 says, for whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. So if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you, have you ever taken that action in your life? This isn't a need to stand up, a need to raise a hand, a need to come forward, a need to fill out a card. Have you believed in the depths of your heart, God raised Jesus from the dead for my sin, and I find freedom and forgiveness from the wrath of God and for my sin through Jesus Christ, and he is my Lord, and I am working in every way that I can to follow his word and to show him to the world around me. Like, we have to be doing these things. I hate to sound so urgent, like I'm placing undue burdens on you, but I'm not, because the Word of God tells us to do these things. We don't just get to come to church, listen to a message, say, wow, that was really good, and walk away and do nothing. We do not get to do that. 12 men died bloody to carry the message of Jesus Christ to people, to watch lives change, to watch nations be transformed. And we exist today, the Church of God, globally, because of their testimony thousands of years ago. And we sit and we're comfortable and we like everything. But does the Spirit of God really dwell in you? Have you truly dealt with salvation? I didn't understand what this stuff was for a long time in my own life. It was just stuff that I knew. Like, I've known this stuff for years. I mean, what am I? I guess I'm 35, so I think I can actually say decades. Like, for most of my life, I have always known what the Word of God says. But for a lot of my life, I was not a regenerate soul simply because of the information I knew. I had to learn and understand that in my life, I have to believe, confess, and act on that belief and confession. And as we looked the past several weeks with Sodom and Gomorrah, the testimony of Lot, that costs a lot in our lives. It's going to cost a lot more in eternity. You are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. If the Spirit of God dwells in you, you are not of the flesh. You have been set free and you need to put it away. You're like, oh, I'm free. Then that means if I'm free, then I'm okay, right? Yeah, you're okay as long as you stay away from the evil deeds of the world. You know, we don't get to be saved and then just partake in the sin that we walked away from. We'd be done with it. We walk away from it. Middle of verse 9. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. I read that the other day, and I thought back to a time in my life where I am fairly convinced I did not have the Spirit of Christ in me. And that was a punch to the gut. I was just sitting at my desk, my Bible just laid open with one little light over top of it. If you ever visited me in my office, you know, I just have one little light that shines on the Bible. I sit there, and I read that, and I'm just like, I did not belong to Jesus. But praise God. Praise God that I was able to figure out belief and confession in my life. To the best of my ability, standing before you now, I believe that I belong to the risen Savior, Jesus Christ, that he is my Lord, and I work at that every single minute of every single day. Verse 10, if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the spirit is alive because of righteousness. We're saying like our flesh is just weak, sinful flesh, right? Don't we say it all the time? You know, I'm just human. Our flesh is dead and full of rotting sin without Jesus Christ. That's what we are. And by nature, in this life, we are always going to fight the temptation of our youthful, sinful, human desires. Temptation's not going away for any of us. Strongest Christian in the room, strongest Christian you know in your life, temptation every day, right? What do we learn about Jesus? He was tempted in all ways as we are. As long as we are in this flesh, on this earth, we face temptation of sin. What is temptation? Evil desire rises within you. Your own heart's desire. I want this. I covet that. I'm going to do this. And we move away from God because of the desire of our heart. James talks all about it. If Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the spirit is alive because of righteousness. And in that righteousness, we can pursue God. And in that righteousness, we can deny the flesh. And in that righteousness, we can honor God and find increased strength in denying the flesh. Kind of getting a picture as we work through this, the closer to God, the stronger to resist the flesh. The farther from God, the more of the chance you're going to be consumed by your evil desires, all throughout the Bible. If Christ is in you, though the body is dead, the body is dead because of sin, yet the spirit is alive because of righteousness. While verse 11. But if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. Some of the most awesome words in the Bible. Right? I don't know if we realize it. I don't know when you read what hits you, what doesn't. This past spring, I was working through Ephesians with the young adults, and we read through Ephesians chapter 1, and there is the verse that it's around 19 or 20, something like that. It says, the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. We're just not freed and saved to the knowledge of a Savior. We are freed and saved for the Savior to live in us. The Spirit of God lives in us. Paul said, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. People are like, I'm just trying to live a Christian life. Stop trying to live a Christian life and start allowing the Spirit of God to live in your life. If you are trying to live a Christian life, then you are not allowing the Spirit of God to live through you. You are trying to do it. I cannot. Jesus said, it is impossible for man to do anything. It is not possible for you, but it is possible for me. We believe, we confess, we repent, and we allow Jesus to live through us. We allow Jesus to govern our thoughts, our actions, our words, where we go, what we do. We allow the Spirit of God control in our lives. And I think that a lot of people come really close to the good news of Jesus Christ and they're like, wow, I like that word because it talks about my salvation because I'm wretched and I need salvation. And then they get close to believing the truth, yet I think they just put like a wall up and like, I got that, I can do that. No, you cannot surrender your life to Jesus. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. What is that to say? The body's dead, right? We're not able in our flesh to do anything. But if the spirit of God dwells in us, even this dead flesh can do things that honor God, but not apart from the Spirit. So today we have two things in front of us. Are you living according to the flesh? Because no amount of saying I do these things is going to change what you are or are not doing. Are you living according to the flesh, or are you living according to the Spirit? If you are living according to the Spirit, all the way back to the first verse where we started today. If you are living according to the flesh, condemnation remains for you. Now, hear what I'm saying. If you are living according to the flesh, we already talked about temptation of sin. There is a struggle that we fight. And the Bible is full of men and women who struggled and fell. They struggled with sin. They were redeemed by the Lord. The sin struggle is not gone. Paul said it just verses before. I find this at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. The Bible is full of imperfect people that struggled with sin throughout their life. I'm not talking about struggling with sin, where we do slowly find the ability to not struggle anymore. There were sin struggles at one point in my life that I do not struggle with now. And I plead for the protection of God over my life to stay strong in those areas. But it was through much prayer and much time in the Word and much counsel that that way of living became a struggle that became a dead work in the world. But that doesn't mean that there's not still sin that I struggle with in my life. I'm not talking about the sin struggle. There are those who live according to the flesh, perhaps sitting in this room, perhaps appearing to be all put together with their Bible in their lap. Are you living according to the flesh? If you are, there is condemnation. Or are you living according to the Spirit? Because if you are, then the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free. And I, for one, am ready to see Christians stand up and start living according to the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus and stop holding their own condemnation over their head. I'm tired of watching people be hindered in their service to God. I'm tired of watching people struggle with things that they should just be done with. I'm tired of watching people struggle with sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. I want to see Christians free from condemnation as God has said you are if you have believed in Jesus as the risen Son of God. If you have confessed Him as Lord. If you have repented of your ways. There is no more condemnation. Let's walk in the freedom that Jesus Christ brings. Don't hold condemnation over your head. Don't let it keep you. Like, I can't, you just don't understand. I've done so many things. There's no way that God can use me. Then we need to sit down and open the Bible, and I will walk you through the people in the Word of God who had done so many things, but were used by God because they surrendered in their life to Him. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you are in Christ Jesus this morning, there is no condemnation for you. You are free. Walk in the newness of life that Christ brings. Let's pray this morning. Heavenly Father, God, I am so thankful for the freedom that Jesus Christ brings to the lives of sinners. God, I am thankful that we were dead in our sins, that we were helpless, that we were powerless. But you sent your Son. I am thankful for God in the flesh, Jesus Christ, who bore my sin to Calvary, and not just mine, the sin of the world. Every person in this room, every person that has ever lived, every person that will ever live, Jesus Christ, God, thank you. Thank you for the redemptive work of your Son. Father, I pray that we would walk forward, not under condemnation, not under self-condemnation, but we would realize when we believe in Jesus Christ, we confess Him as Lord, we repent. God, you have freed us from sin. You have saved us from the wrath of your judgment upon disobedience. What an amazing God. Father, I pray for freedom in the lives of those that are here today. I pray that this word, your word, God, would dwell in their heart. That Christians would begin rising up and walking in the freedom that you have given them. God, and that more would know because of their testimony to who you are. Father, you are an infinitely great God. We love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Just stand and worship with us this morning.